Good morning, thank you, and welcome to GTS 2021. Today we have a very exciting panel with us, which would be focusing on this conversation with Quad scientific advisors, science technology cooperation in the Quad, and we are trying to pick up issues which are of great significance when it comes to our partnership and the way forward in the Indo-Pacific region. As you know, the Quad Statement on Science, Technology, Innovation Partnership has laid out the broad contours in which we need to see the spirit of the Quad. The 12th March 2021 statement is absolutely clear in terms of how we see FOIP, the Free Open Indo-Pacific Region, what kind of challenges we see. Post-pandemic, the resilience that we are looking at in terms of our infrastructure cooperation, our ability to bring out science technology in response to certain monopolistic tendencies that have come up in the region, and how some of the countries have also tried to disrupt the supply chains and the resilience that was required. The health security is a major issue, not only for these countries, but across the continents. And they, I think the leadership that was needed, both in terms of technology, but also in terms of the transparency that was required by institutions like WHO, have also in a way squeezed off the space that national governments had to respond to the major challenge that we ended up with. And these require a greater response in terms of our ability to bring in technologies. The COP26 has also placed several issues on the table. Some of them were addressed and some of them could not be addressed because, again, the nature of cooperation that we expected hasn't come through. And this, I think, is important for us to bring out how these dimensions are to be addressed. So from that point of view, today's conversation is also likely to bring in the issues, as I said, post-COVID challenges. The vaccine inequity that we have ended up with, the whole question of access, equity, and inclusion of which we have been talking about. The Quad statement has made some references to the access and equity issues. I think inclusion is equally important as we are moving in with new technologies. There are different development challenges that technology has to address. And it's not just in Quad, but across the world. And that inequity we see. Dr. VijayRaghavan, of course, would be telling us about the development challenges that India shares with several of our African countries, our countries in Indo-Pacific. So those development challenges and the trajectories of development on which different countries are, the amount of efforts that are needed, the amount of cooperation that is needed would be very different. The joint statement from the Quad leaders has also brought out the very issue of the COVAX facility and the dimensions that are needed in terms of the 1.2 billion doses that we required after the COVID vaccine process started. The financial support for this, the ability of the industry to respond to it are some of the major issues that have begun there. But let me now bring in our very accomplished panel from India. We are joined in by Professor VijayRaghavan, the Principal Scientific Advisor to the Government of India. From Australia, we have Dr. Kathy Foley, the Chief Scientist of the Government of Australia. From Japan, we have Professor Yoichiro Matsumoto, Scientific and Technology Advisor to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Government of Japan. And from US, we have Dr. Alison Schwer, Acting Science and Technology Advisor to the Secretary of State, the White House. So with this accomplished panel, let me invite Dr. VijayRaghavan as our lead this morning. Dr. Raghavan, you have been contributing immensely in terms of how Indian government looks at the whole question of integration of science, technology, innovation in our broad development philosophy, and of course, in the issues that are coming out of the new, I would say, disruption that is happening through new modalities and new engagements and disengagements. with your huge experience in biotechnology and now increasingly many areas that are important for the new industries, particularly the semiconductor and the challenges that countries are facing because of this disruption that has happened. How can Quad countries collaborate to build this resilient supply chains? And what exactly you see in terms of the guiding principles that are important? And that's my first question to you, Dr. VijayRaghavan.
Thank you very much, Professor Sachin Chaturvedi. And it's a great pleasure to be here with my distinguished colleagues from the US, Australia, and Japan. We've been having, by the way, discussions of chief scientists across the world, and colleagues from these countries have also been there with us. And that's been very valuable. And we've been discussing issues related to the pandemic primarily, of course, but other issues are and keep coming up. Now, the point you brought up about is about supply chains in, you know, essentially deep tech or high tech areas. And what the reason we are in the position we are in is because of a lack of foresight amongst us about our need to pay now for costs rather than postpone them to the future. And because we postponed environmental, biodiversity, and industrial costs for our, you know, I'm trying to use a polite word, need for goods right now, we ended up pushing manufacturing to the cheapest, highest quality location and became substantially consumers or assemblers. Now, this is both a problem in network dynamics. You have networks with one or two strong nodes, they're unstable. And it's also a problem in economics and politics and equitable development. Now, this has to change. Fortunately, the good news is that the way science and technology has changed allows this, you know, movement from strong few nodes to multiple nodes possible. And that's because, of course, communications in multiple ways, AI, machine learning, and other tools added onto that. But fundamentally, manufacturing also can be now much more efficient and local in many areas, and then products distributed as needed. And this is something I won't go into in detail now, but in areas such as semiconductors, in biotech, in additive and subtractive manufacturing, in all the components which go into forward-looking energy industry, such as solar and hydrogen, we need to have multiple nodes and multiple distribution mechanisms. So at the foundation of an R&D collaboration needs to be on one side, looking at new advances in fundamental research, and another side, a link into these pressing areas of manufacturing, which need to, of course, address at the next step downstream, health, agriculture, and sustainable development. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. VijayRaghavan. You have very rightly identified priority areas where Quad may collaborate. And I think that's the new emphasis that Prime Minister Modi has been talking about in terms of triangular cooperation. And I think these solutions probably for several of our African partners and our partners among ASEAN countries, particularly CLMV countries, would be extremely important. Let me now turn to Dr. Kathy. Dr. Kathy, as head of Australia's as chief scientist, you have been identifying your term as something which is associated with the idea of open access. There are several statements that I could see by you on open access, and you have been one of the advocates of this philosophy of open access, and I've been talking about this idea. And I was quite excited to see this because we have also been talking, and in fact, one of the first GM product that came up in India with the IIT Kharagpur actually came with this open access philosophy that could provide an alternative to a monopoly. So how you see Quad's role in promoting this idea of open access?
Oh, thank you, Sachin. It's really great to be here and joining my Quad fellows to talk to you today. Yes, open access, I think, is absolutely critical for humanity. And the reason I say that is that academic research and the related innovations, they've been the basis for the success of humanity, you know, being able to fight a pandemic, looking at even knowing that climate change is happening, creating the technologies that we use and take for granted today, and are absolutely critical for being able to sustain the human race on this planet, as well as looking into the future to make sure that we are positioning what we're doing in a way that is sustainable, as Vijay mentioned before. You know, the sorts of things that you mentioned, Vijay, were absolutely critical. But how can we make sure that everyone understands the power of this research that is done when it's mostly hidden behind paywalls, just because of the way things have evolved over the decades of the way the research sector is set up? We all know that the trust that's been created by the peer review process and the role that academic publishers have is absolutely critical. But what has happened over time, especially as we've moved from hard copy library-based subscription models to ones which are digitally based, we've missed the chance to see how we could switch the business model so it's one which allows everyone to be able to get the value of the research that is done globally. So the approach that I've had is that we're seeing that at the moment, the number of publishers, journals, and the amount of research that is published has got to the point where no one library has subscriptions and access to all research literature. And when you think about it, it's sort of a little bit nuts, isn't it? That we've created this amazing human ingenuity, knowledge base, and yet for some reason we've set it up so that we're not able to embrace it regardless of where you are in the world, whether you're a low GDP country who's evolving and developing, through to the highest GDP countries who are able to really forge ahead as well. So what I have been doing is, with that in mind, thinking, well, we've looked at open access so far, and it's been a sort of a patch band-aid approach that's been taken to try and think, how can we navigate the system? But when you look at it, it's not a normal sort of process where we've got a mixture of contributions that are in kind, such as government-funded research is made available to publishers and they take the copyright and add to that. I don't want to diminish the role of the publication houses. We do the peer review, which a paper came out recently. In Australia, our contribution to the peer review is about, I think it's $19 to $35 million a year. In Australia, we do about $12 billion worth of research that is published. And then, of course, the editorial process, which is absolutely critical to make sure that we have the best papers being and the policies and the things that make the whole system work, is done where it's a token payment. So, for example, I'm the editor-in-chief of a journal of superconductivity, superconducting science and technology. And you get a payment which works out to be about probably $1.50 an hour, I think, is the payment to be able to do that role. So it's not a true payment. But then we've got to a point now where many publishers are making very significant profits, which says there's a lot of money in the system, and it's right for us to be able to see how we can shift it so that we respect the role of publishers to be able to run the business, because that's critical. They do the front end and the back end of the IT that allows this the system to work. But how can we bring, and what I'm looking at is bringing together all the funds in the system, and we've worked out that it's many hundreds of millions of dollars that Australia pays to publishers every year, have that centralized, and then have a central agency be able to negotiate single agreements for the country with each of the publishers, so that we can have open access to all people residing in Australia. And if you think each country doing this, you'll start seeing this becoming the norm. So the publishers, instead of having a multitude of different arrangements, we have a single engagement with the publishers, and there are many thousands of them, so it's not going to be straightforward. And then we also have all the research that is published is from research that originates in Australia is made open access to the rest of the world. I think the benefits of this will be that we will lift the potential for professionals, the general public, We have things like citizen science where and teachers, our public service, industry, especially the small companies that aren't in a position to have subscriptions, will be able to embrace this full literature and be able to use this for the benefit of prosperity and well-being. And I think we just have to look at what happened where the COVID research was made available. Many publishers entered into an agreement. I think it was thanks to something that came from the USA initiating this. And as a consequence, papers relating to the COVID pandemic were all made open access without an extra payment. And as a consequence, we've, I think, been able to see the incredible rate of discovery progress that has meant that the impact of new vaccines, the way to manage a whole range of things of understanding this virus and how best to manage it has led to where we're at now, which it could have been so much worse if we didn't have access to that information. So that's one of my passion pieces at the moment, but it's also unlocking a realization that the research system that we have in the world is one where the metrics and the way we're sort of all designed to make the system work is not going to allow us to embrace a full human potential with diversity and inclusion unless we make some changes, as well as making sure that we don't have an uneven balance that's getting more uneven as time goes on between low GDP and high GDP countries. I think for us to have, you know, the sort of world we do all envisage will require us to see how we can make research, which is at the basis of this, available to everyone.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Dr. Kathy. I think it's quite fascinating. I was just wondering how you see this to be extrapolated to other countries, particularly within the Quad. Can we bring in cooperation around this area for larger benefit and we create more public goods?
I think I'm playing the long game because it's a very disruptive approach and I don't want to pretend it's going to be easy. So what we're doing is working our way through, realizing that this isn't about calling anyone out in any way because everyone's got an important role to play, but seeing if we can redesign the system. And if we can get this operating well in Australia, which is a nice medium-sized country, I know in very large countries where it's a much more complex system and so many more libraries and contributions that it's not going to be straightforward, but it's actually, I think what I'm hearing from publishers is there's a real interest to see how this might develop because we all know that the current system and the way it's set up is not something that is sustainable. And it's one where there's a real interest to make sure that research literature is made available. So let's take it one step at a time and absolutely hope that I can engage with the Quad members to see how we can test this and also make sure that we are able to share what we've learned along the way so that they may be able to consider it in their countries.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Let me now turn to Professor Matsumoto. Sir, you have heard Dr. VijayRaghavan and Dr. Kathy talking about areas which are exciting in terms of both the development challenges that Dr. Raghavan alluded to and Dr. Kathy's solution in terms of how do we bring in collective efforts in a consolidated manner. She has been trying to address this through open access. I wanted to bring your attention to the recently held Quad Foreign Ministers meeting for technology cooperation, which has identified certain areas. What specific areas or sectors you think Quad nations can focus on to enhance technology cooperation in the Indo-Pacific?
Okay, thank you very much. I would like to thank you for this opportunity to speak with distinguished guests. And it is very important to build a network of scientists regarding the Quad countries who can collaborate not only on technology cooperation to address geopolitical and security issues, but also on way and innovation to deal with global issues such as climate change, Of course, we need many technologies to overcome this climate change. Okay, and I've got three questions from you. At first, I'd like to give an answer to the three questions. First one is, what is specific area of cooperation? It's very important. I believe that the main area of our cooperation in technology will be in line with the result of the second Quad Summit held September 24th. It's already shown you, and it is an initiative that will deepen our ties and advance practical cooperation. So the main area of cooperation include improved production of and early access to safe and effective vaccines for COVID-19 and further infectious disease, promoting high standards of infrastructure, and addressing climate change. Partnering in critical and emerging technology, space and cyber. And the fifth, nurturing the next generation of talent. Maybe it's very important for us. Practical cooperation among the Quad members has been taking place in various fields, including quality infrastructure, maritime security, counterterrorism, cybersecurity, and humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. Further, agreement has been reached to strengthen our cooperation in the areas such as space, clean energy, and people-to-people exchange or communication. I've got a second environment. Could you wait a bit? I need to control my
You're running out of battery?
Oh, yeah. Just wait, I will connect to electricity. Okay, just wait. Okay, I did. no problem now. And the second question is environmental issues. At the World Leaders Summit held during the COP26, Prime Minister Kishida expressed Japan's commitment to promoting measure to combat climate change. And he has positioned the period up to 2030 as a decisive decade and called on all parties to take ambitious climate change measures. In addition, he also presents Japan's effort in this field, including a new 2030 green gas reduction target. I'm not sure we can do what we should do our best. An additional comment of up to $10 billion in financial support. And from the public and private sectors over the next 5 years, a doubling of financial support for its adoption, promotion of green innovation and participation in the global methane pledge. In addition, Japan set up a Japan pavilion at the venue of 26. I will skip it through the anyhow. We have many showcases to the world. And these exhibitions and the seminars was based on the following two pillars. I should say first, Japan's effort toward the 2050 carbon neutral goal, and the second, its effort to support the decarbonization transition, mainly in the Asia Pacific regions area. In our official side event titled Regional Climate Week's Global High-Level Event, the significance of the Asia Pacific Climate Week hosted by Japan and its financial support to the world were introduced. In addition, the importance of life cycle management of alternative so-called freon and was introduced through the relevant ministers meeting. One of the recent topics on climate change is the global methane pledge led by the US and the EU. Japan announced its participation during the second Quad Summit. As a front runner in methane reduction, Japan is particularly expected to take initiatives such as sharing the successful domestic effort to reduce methane emission as good practices. And from this perspective, we believe that Japan can contribute to the greenhouse gas reduction in the world by participating in the global methane pledge and continuing to show the leadership, including through this initiative. As to the third question, it's to develop standards and for critical technologies, kind of PIs and so on. It is also recognized that the commercial technologies, including emerging technologies such as 5G, IoT, AI, and nowadays quantum technologies, do bring economic benefit, while at the same time they can affect civil liberties, human rights, and even national securities. Maybe we should seriously think about economic security. And I recognize that it is becoming increasingly important to protect and promote high-level principles such as human-centered values, inclusiveness, and accountability so that these technology can contribute to the sound development of free democratic society. I believe that it is essential to actively engage in international cooperation from this perspective by collaborating with the Quad member states and other like-minded countries. Recently, as economic and social reforms through digitalization are accelerating to create new global market is a key factor. In this context, international collaboration on IP strategies, including technology standards, is becoming much more important. Japan is more entry and the creation of new market from the perspective of economic security, as well as achieving sustainable economic growth. Therefore, Japan has been promoting the joint effort of the public and private sectors including the establishment of a contact group on specific sectors regarding the development of international technical standards. It is also important to promote public-private partnership and more specifically, industry, government, academia partnership within each country. Also, it is essential to closely connect the networks among industry, government, and academia in each country to the multi-layered networks among the Quad member states. To strengthen information exchange and collaboration. In this regard, I believe that creating informal multi-layered networks will strengthen the momentum of our mutual cooperation by utilizing platforms such as the SCS Forum held in Kyoto, which is known as the equivalent to the Davos Forum in the field of science and technology. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Professor Matsumoto, for a very comprehensive response. And I think you have mentioned several issues on which I would very much like to come back, not only to you, but to all our other panelists, particularly the idea of institutionalizing cooperation among Quad countries. Can we really think of some kind of virtual setup to promote this? Because the several dimensions that you have mentioned, I think you have very rightly emphasized on human-centric ethos that we need with accountability at the as a pivot in this. We know how synthetic biology that was reported almost 2 years back in an international conference, they show the lack of accountability. The response later was not part of the international ethos and practices that have been exercised by all countries in biosafety and similar other majors. That same logic also applies to oceans and outer space. So I think accountability, responsibility to global community and to our own citizens, I think is important. So thanks a lot, Professor Matsumoto, for your very comprehensive response. Let me now turn to Dr. Allison. Dr. Allison, you have been talking about several different dimensions, and I was quite pleasantly surprised to hear your statement at the sixth multi-stakeholder forum on science, technology, innovation for sustainable development goals. In fact, that's one area Dr. VijayRaghavan has been promoting along with Japan, how STI may be leveraged for SDGs, and they have become part of a network that Japan is supporting in five African countries, along with World Bank and the UN ECOSOC on STI for SDGs. In fact, I had the opportunity of working with Dr. VijayRaghavan precisely on that subject. So this is one way you have emphasized on role of networks, and you have been talking about this in terms of both participation and, as you made in your observation at this meeting, the sixth multi-stakeholder consultation, about how countries, scientific communities, industries, they may all come together, something that Professor Matsumoto also alluded to when he was talking about PPP, and he talked about closed networks that are needed. How, what is your take? How you see this unfolding, particularly in Quad context?
Thank you so much. And first, let me say thank you for allowing me to be on this panel with such distinguished colleagues. I'm really honored to be here. Thanks also to the Carnegie hosts, especially Shruti Sharma, and of course you, Professor Chaturvedi, for moderating this discussion. So I think your question gets to an excellent point. Quadrilateral cooperation is the way to bring diverse perspectives and our comparative strengths together to pioneer a shared vision for a free and open Indo-Pacific. We are facing new challenges at the intersection of technology and diplomacy, from disinformation to unlawful use of new surveillance tools, to cyber intrusions, to co-option and misuse, all from technologies that we once assumed would reinforce democratic principles. So we know that technology can help us address some of these most critical global challenges of today, many which have been mentioned by my colleagues already: the climate crisis, food security, current and future pandemics. So the best way we can uphold our shared values and ensure that science and technological advances are used to empower people in our societies is to make sure the United States and like-minded countries such as India, Japan, and Australia are beacons of technological innovation through investing in our domestic capabilities, but also building and maintaining strong networks of countries, companies, civil society, and universities. Only then can we shape the global evolution of technology in a manner consistent with our values and maintain our strategic collective leadership on technological issues. It's absolutely impossible to do this without elevating international science and technology cooperation and coordination. This technological innovation is occurring globally, and we are now reaching a crossroads in time where innovation can occur and is occurring anywhere and everywhere. So it's imperative that we empower the current and next generation STEM communities to be innovative, because by being innovative and curious, scientific discovery will thrive and we can maximize the benefit of STEM for humanity. Our STEM professionals in our four countries, but certainly beyond, in the private sector, government, and academia are at the forefront of this change. So we benefit enormously from the intellectual exchanges with bright minds from all around the world. Science and technology underpin many of today's economic, social security, and diplomatic challenges, and the solutions to these challenges require these partnerships. STEM is collaborative, transnational, an engine to enable transformative changes. So this collaboration should operate under a shared set of principles and values, some of which were already mentioned by Kathy. The global research system rests on principles of openness, transparency, reciprocity, merit-based competition, which ensures the system operates with integrity and fosters trust. And since the world is in fact very diverse, you need a diverse team to design technology that is reflective of that reality and ensure accountability, like you mentioned. Homogeneous teams are simply not going to be as successful in delivering real benefits to people's lives. So scientific progress depends on someone seeing questions or answers that no one has seen before, because they're bringing a different lens, different experiences, different questions, different passions to the equation. The other benefit from quad collaboration is that we can forge new standards for our expectations of what it means to do technology collaboration in ways that emphasize diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility. We know that our technology and people benefit when we take the time to support and engage underrepresented and underserved groups in our critical and emerging technology work. We can seize this opportunity as quad partners who share democratic values to say that we want to be more inclusive in terms of who is doing the research and development, but also in how these advancements benefit and are accessible to our people. So I think the point you raised about the STI Forum is really great, because the importance of STI for achieving sustainable development is widely recognized as critical and cross-cutting by many countries and stakeholder groups. The talent and resources to harness STI are diverse and multifaceted, and certainly not the domain of any one institution or one country. So a list of the applicable technologies that will contribute to the advancement of SDGs is expansive, and it will evolve over time. Some of them are addressed as part of the Quad's working groups, some are cross-cutting, some contribute to climate and health initiatives. But fundamentally, as we think about deploying these in support of the SDGs, we need to prioritize human rights, democratic values, foster cooperation, establish guardrails against misuse or malign action, and reduce uncertainty, manage the risk that competition will lead to conflict. The great news is that the Quad countries represent almost a quarter of the world population, over a quarter of global GDP, and a great percentage of top technical talent to bring to bear significant expertise in these fields. So for example, biotechnology, which was mentioned already, is a focus for the Quad Horizon Scanning Sub Working Group, and it has significant potential in advancing SDGs 2 and 3. So I think with that, I'll go ahead and start to close. But when the United States and Quad countries can come together and work on science and technology issues jointly, we have tremendous ability to shape the rules, the norms, the standards, and the values that provide the foundation for our increasingly interwoven international science and technology ecosystem. This will benefit our respective economic and national security beyond just the Quad, but also the Indo-Pacific writ large. So now we just need to continue the partnership, which I think and hope that we'll discuss today. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Dr. Allison, for very, very substantive observations. And I think your idea of quadrilateral cooperation based on comparative advantages of each of the members and shared values, I think is extremely important observation. You have further qualified it by mentioning the idea of democracy, the idea of accountability, and the free democratic societies. You have emphasized on access, equity, and inclusion, along with the idea of SDI for SDG. I think this is an absolutely fascinating area. But I just wanted to ask you a supplementary question in terms of how you see this to be done in a world where countries are continuously undermining the accountability component. You have suggested norm setting, but there are continuous endeavors to undermine well-established norms and the red lines in R&D and its integration with, Professor Matsumoto said, commercial interests of certain. How do you think Quad can actually prevail with some kind of global architecture?
I think that's such a wonderful question, and I can certainly start on it and welcome my colleagues to also join in. I think much of it comes to conversations that need to happen, which is why it's been a principal foundation of at least the Biden-Harris administration that multinational and multilateral cooperation is extremely important. So the United States certainly coming back to these engagements and discussing these things with our partners, allies, and beyond is critically important, because at some point you have to understand the problem and issue in a shared perspective, not necessarily identical, but at least understanding the lexicon that's being used to describe things so that you are able to work together on the areas where you're clearly aligned and move forward with tangible progress. So I think in many ways, many of these conversations are happening. On research security, for instance, there's much activity within the G7, and there are a number of other examples, even from the Quad, in terms of discussions on 5G or Open RAN, et cetera. So I think having the space to have those conversations is the first step. And that's certainly something that the Quad Working Group on Critical and Emerging Technology, among other groups, is focusing very hard to do, to achieve that space to have these conversations.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Dr. Allison. Let me now turn into a new round and let me go back to Dr. VijayRaghavan. I think this time I'm asking one common question to everyone, and that has two components. One, as Dr. Allison very rightly said, what are the norms and how we achieve them, bring in other countries, engage them in terms of norm setting so that we ensure the shared values for democracy, for accountability, and also in terms of ensuring a free and wider access. Now, having initiated this, the second component of my question is, how do we institutionalize our cooperation within the Quad? Can we think of this idea? I think, as Allison rightly mentioned, the idea of SDI for SDG, which is something of leveraging science technology for sustainability, which each one of you have mentioned. Can we think of a quad initiative on sustainability through science and technology. So these are the two questions that I have, and I would go around the table. Let me begin with Dr. VijayRaghavan. Dr. Raghavan.
Yeah, thank you very much, Sachin. These are both very important points. You know, in science and technology cooperation, there are two components. One, which is, you know, baseline on science, and there are rules and, you know, practices on how we cooperate, how we exchange material freely, yet protect intellectual property. And that's not difficult to understand. And each country has, you know, processes. It'll be very valuable for the Quad to lay out what these processes are so that we all, you know, have a baseline commonality there, but also something which others can adapt. There are, of course, other components to this which end up being a little more contentious, and they relate to trade. But this first component, which is anchored in science, is something much easier to collaborate on. So that's something which we must put in place, have a quad interaction space where all these are formulated, particularly in emerging technologies, also in areas such as data privacy and, you know, protection and cybersecurity. And these kinds of norms can be put in place so that not only we follow them, not only do we share them, but these are models for everyone else. The second component is institutionalization. And while, you know, there's our quad working groups on this, networks on this, we need to examine how we can take this institutionalization on a longer term. Post Second World War, institutionalization of international institutions meant a big brick and mortar structure dedicated to a particular topic, typically with Western scientists, you know, dealing with Southern problems, as it were, in a manner where, you know, we know the answers and we will tell you how to solve them. The world has changed dramatically since then. And given the large number of young people in our area, in the Quad, this needs to be done in a more distributed, not a brick and mortar way, yet many, many times more effective. We should take inspiration from collaborative structures such as the European Molecular Biology Organization, which is linked to the European Molecular Biology Laboratory, to CERN, to see how deep tech collaboration across space can take place in a manner which is effective and focuses on quality development of people who will serve not only our countries, but the world. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Dr. VijayRaghavan. Can I turn to you, Dr. Kathy?
I think we're always starting from a great position. I think having principles and values is a really fantastic starting point, which means that everyone sort of knows where they're coming from. And when things go pear-shaped, which sometimes they do, where, you know, you do end up with some conflict, you've actually got a place to go back to say, why are we connecting in the way we are? But then the other is also, when you're talking about things which is institutionalized relationships, means that you're setting it up in a way where there's clarity of purpose, clarity of the way to engage, and also knowing how you're going to pay for it, I think, because quite often things that get in the way when you're trying to do collaborations is working out, particularly when, you know, in the Quad we've got I was amazed to hear, I didn't realize there's a quarter of the world's GDP and a quarter of the world's population. That's extraordinary. And so we've got a lot of resources, but I think recognizing where your priorities are and what's important and how this can lead to outcomes which you couldn't achieve by going it alone. So that it's almost like creating that value proposition, which means that you can't not engage. And that's where you get the longevity, because it's almost like saying we're going to be turning off the air we breathe or the food we eat, because this is what's needed to actually nurture ourselves as a, not just as the four countries in the quadrilateral relationship, but it's actually showing almost like a way that is possible when we're saying that we have shared values, democratic freedoms that we think are important. And it's almost showcasing what is possible by operating in a way which is able to navigate those challenges, which are always going to be there. Cultural, the need for countries to be successful in their own standing, but recognizing where the value is by those engagements. And then remembering that at the end of the day, it's about the human relationships, the one-to-one recognition that everyone wants to be successful in their own right, that everyone wants to be able to forge a way that creates purpose in their lives and allows them to have the happiness, freedom, the sort of things which just humans want to begin with. And I really liked Professor Masatoko's idea of being human-centered values and human-centered in, especially as we're moving towards the opportunities for digital technologies, which will allow us, you know, I think the COVID pandemic gave us a bit of a step change in the way we can engage, because before, if we're going to have any interaction, we'd all jump on an aeroplane, extra cost, go across the world, engage, come back again, and there was, you know, gaps in engagement. What we found during the pandemic was that we are in a day, you know, for me, starting the morning in the USA and finishing the evening in Europe and everywhere else across Australia and the Asia Pacific area during the day. And that was just the norm now. And digital capability in communications means that we can actually cut through in ways which will allow us to achieve our goals. But the thing is, at some stage, we've got to get down to the specific projects and identifying what they are. But I think having clear goals, and I think Vijay's list of topic areas, which I think we should be covering, are things which are ones where it's clear, you know, we do want to work out how to prevent future pandemics. We do want to be able to master the climate change requirements. We do want to have, you know, sort of manufacturing of the future and digital capability that is safe and sustainable and delivering on the sustainable development goals. And if you identify the things which are most important and sort of do a few things really well, I think that that creates that institutionalization of the relationship. So it becomes something where you couldn't live without it. And you would, you know, it'd be like you'd be cutting off your reason for living by not progressing with it. So that would be the way I would approach it.
Thank you. Thanks, Kathy. Let me now turn to Professor Matsumoto. We are running out of time now. So Professor Matsumoto, please.
Yeah, they're very sheltering. And so maybe important things is how to make a kind of network of networks between among our countries. And especially the important things is how to nurture the young talent together, not only in Japan, not only in the US, not only in India, nurture those kind of peoples. And also important things, as Professor Fawzi said, that how to make good metrics to measure our academic activities and so on. The how to visualize our society. Many people are talking about accountability or those things, but we should get the real concrete metrics that are measured to decide our future, activities. And also important things, we have many technologies. How to make industries or how to help our problems facing or such kind of things. And how to make verify those things in real society. Now, for example, talking about hydrogen energy. In Japan, we cannot make many hydrogen energy. For example, we should collaborate Australian peoples to make a green hydrogen. And after that, we should bring to Japan by ships or by tankers, hydrogen tankers or something, so that In that real collaboration, we should think about what's a real good concrete things. And we need a good communication with the government, and not only government, academia, and industries people. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Professor Matsumoto. Dr. Allison, can I come back to you?
Yes, of course. And just to be quick, so I don't repeat things that my colleagues have said, many of which I strongly agree with, I think in many ways it comes down to ensuring that we're reducing the barriers that are getting in the way of the types of collaboration and coordination that we all want to have. We agree more on our shared values than we don't. And having that base to return to, as was previously mentioned, is critically important. I think also in terms of institutionalizing, some of the things that we should think about are, again, as mentioned, using technology to facilitate engagements in different ways than we may have previously done, but also ensuring that we are thinking about broadening these conversations and really bringing in multi-stakeholder perspectives, which are critically important beyond gov-to-gov discussions, but really ensuring that we are giving those opportunities for our scientific exchanges, our academia to engage, civil society, private sector, on all of these different topics, because they have so much to contribute to these conversations, and we want to make sure that that space is open and available to them as well.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. As we are now about to close, let me quickly pick up my takes out of this excellent and very substantive conversation. Thanks a lot to our panelists today. I think we have captured the broad ideas that are there in terms of quad technology cooperation, the ideas that are there in terms of our engagement, and also the broad trajectory that we should think of as we go forward. I think Dr. VijayRaghavan has very rightly mentioned in terms of not going for brick and mortar institutions as we did after the Second World War. Probably the time has come to explore technologies, Dr. Kathy emphasized, in terms of leveraging technology and identifying new areas that are important. I think all the four panelists amazingly have conversed quite well in terms of centrality of value systems. And I think this is a great, great message from this panel. Science, technology, innovation require consistent commitment for values and ethos. The values and ethos which are shared across these countries, but also, as Professor Matsumoto said, central to our human-centric value system. And I think that, as Professor Matsumoto, I recall, was also the theme of Japan's G20 presidency. And human-centric development is something that Japan has been pressing for. And I think several of us have borrowed that phrase for the kind of globalization that we need. Prime Minister Modi has articulated the new dimension of development and globalization with human face. So I think that dimension stands. The second point definitely is about a new initiative that Quad countries can consider is on leveraging science, technology, innovation for sustainable development goals, for sustainable development, how to deliver on SDGs, as Kathy rightly asked. Professor Matsumoto also very rightly emphasized on bringing in young talent and emphasizing on issues that are relevant to them. This is not very different from what Dr. Kathy said in terms of future pandemics, future manufacturing, and delivering on SDGs with identified values and shared commitments. That kind of ideas she emphasized in terms of we realizing the importance of interdependence. Solo flights are no more going to deliver. We need to realize this interdependence and take this forward in terms of how we go in terms of collective efforts and collective redressal. In her earlier round, she emphasized on open access, and that I think is a a very important point from this panel as to how within our national efforts to deliver on domestic capacities, how we address the idea of open access. And then we see without adversely affecting, because you might have seen several write-ups in several journals about this whole issue of open access in a very polarized debate. So we need to unlock it and bring out issues where a cost of accessing knowledge is not too high and not exclusive. It should be inclusive. And that inclusivity would come in with new efforts that are needed. I think Dr. VijayRaghavan has rightly raised in this context the point of baseline commonalities that are there. And those baseline commonalities would help us in identification of new areas as we think of institutionalization, something that Dr. Allison very rightly articulated her point in terms of focusing on new technologies and multi-stakeholder connect within a network mode, I think is absolutely fascinating. So with these few takes, I would very much like to close this conversation and would very much like to thank Kangi for giving us this platform of conversing, exploring future areas of cooperation and institutionalizing of science, technology, innovation, cooperation among the Quad countries. Thanks a lot to my panel. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone else.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.